Today I will be presenting a VAP on aortic stenosis. After viewing this VAP, you will be able to identify the epidemiology and typical presentation of aortic stenosis, understand the clinical evaluation and diagnosis of aortic stenosis, and finally understand the various management strategies of aortic stenosis. This VAP will cover epidemiology, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical diagnosis, evaluation, medical therapy, and surgical/interventional therapy of aortic stenosis. There are three main causes of valvular aortic stenosis. The first main cause is calcification of a congenitally abnormal aortic valve, typically either bicuspid or unicuspid. Bicuspid aortic valves are the most common congenital heart defect with a prevalence between 0.5% and 2%. It typically affects males to females in a 3-to-1 ratio. The second main cause of valvular aortic stenosis is calcification of a normal trileaflet valve. This is especially common in patients who have chronic kidney disease as they are predisposed to have calcium deposition. Finally, the third main cause of valvular aortic stenosis is rheumatic heart disease. If it is found to be affecting the aortic valve, rheumatic heart disease almost always is associated with mitral stenosis as well. Other rare causes of valvular aortic stenosis include Fabry's disease, systemic lupus erythematosus, and Paget's disease. The relative frequency of these causes of aortic stenosis varies geographically. In the U.S., calcification of either a bicuspid valve or a normal tricuspid valve is the most common cause, with bicuspid valves typically being found in patients diagnosed at a younger age. Worldwide, rheumatic heart disease is the most common cause. The pathophysiology of aortic stenosis is related to the gradual development of aortic valve narrowing over a prolonged period of time, typically measured in decades. As the aortic valve, shown here as number 8, narrows, the left ventricle, shown here as number 9, hypertrophies. This initially leads to appropriate compensation as the LV is able to provide an adequate force. As the valve narrowing continues and there is more obstruction of flow, LVEDP increases due to the poorly compliant ventricle and diastolic dysfunction. This can eventually result in systolic heart failure, but patients typically develop symptoms before systolic heart failure develops. As described in the previous slide, there is typically a significant period of time after the onset of aortic stenosis before patients develop symptoms. Additionally, the degree of aortic valve obstruction that causes symptoms varies significantly between patients. Symptoms first typically become apparent with exertion, with dyspnea on exertion being the most common presenting symptom. This is likely related to diastolic dysfunction and the inability of the LV to increase the cardiac output. Patients can also develop syncope and dizziness, likely associated with decreased cerebral perfusion. Angina pectoris occurs in a significant number of patients and is associated with underlying CAD in about half of patients, while it is felt to be related to LVH inducing coronary ischemia in others. After developing even mild symptoms, patients should be referred for aortic valve replacement as the average survival is only 2 to 3 years with a high risk of sudden cardiac death. Sudden cardiac death before the onset of other symptoms is quite rare, less than 1% in prospective series. Finally, patients are at an increased bleeding risk due to impaired platelet function and decreased levels of von Willebrand factor. This can present as Hayes syndrome, which is GI bleeding from colonic angiodysplasia associated with AS, or other clinical bleeding such as epistaxis. The physical exam findings associated with aortic stenosis include a systolic murmur that typically has a mid to late peak intensity, loudest at the right upper sternal border, as well as a reduced intensity of the second heart sound due to the inability of the valve to close normally. The murmur also radiates to the carotids, and the most useful physical exam finding to rule out AS is lack of radiation to the right carotid. There is typically also a delayed carotid upstroke described as parvus et tardus, or weekend late. Finally, an S4 is often present due to vigorous atrial contraction. Diagnostic testing for AS is typically aimed at identifying both the aortic stenosis as well as the compensatory mechanisms. EKG, which is typically the easiest test to obtain, usually shows left ventricular hypertrophy, though this is a nonspecific finding and has many other causes. Chest X-ray is typically normal when the AS is mild to moderate in severity. but it can show rounding of the left ventricle due to LVH and severe disease, or calcification of the valves in rare cases. Echocardiography is typically the study of choice for diagnosis and monitoring, as it provides accurate and non-invasive assessment of valve morphology, including whether the valve is tricuspid or bicuspid and the extent of calcification. It also provides an accurate and reproducible estimate of the aortic valve size and aortic jet velocity, as well as documenting left ventricular hypertrophy and function. Finally, in patients without symptoms, exercise testing can be helpful to identify an abnormal blood pressure response, exercise-induced symptoms, or a limited exercise capacity. Exercise testing is contraindicated in symptomatic patients due to the risk of complications including sudden death. Cardiac catheterization previously was the diagnostic method of choice, but, given the good test characteristics of echocardiography, it is now only recommended when non-invasive testing is inconclusive. Aortic stenosis is most appropriately described as a disease continuum, and no isolated value can consistently and accurately define severity. The 2008 ACC-AHA guidelines use aortic jet velocity, mean gradient, and valve area to classify severity, with severe AS defined as having a jet velocity greater than 4 meters per second, mean gradient greater than 40 millimeters of mercury, and a valve area less than 1 square centimeter. While there is significant variability in the hemodynamic progression between patients, once moderate aortic stenosis is present, the average increase in jet velocity is 0.3 meters per second per year, the average increase in mean pressure gradient is 7 millimeters of mercury per year, and the average decrease in valve area is 0.1 square centimeters per year. Medical management is typically used in asymptomatic patients. In order to follow for progression of disease, screening echocardiograms should be obtained every 3 to 5 years in patients with mild AS, every 1 to 2 years in patients with moderate AS, and every year in patients with severe AS. While initial trials of statins suggested a benefit, multiple subsequent randomized controlled trials have evaluated the use of statins in an effort to help prevent progression of aortic stenosis, but these have not shown benefit, so statin use for AS alone is not currently recommended. It is important to treat hypertension in patients with AS, but antihypertensive therapy should be started at low doses and gradually titrated up due to the possibility of adverse hemodynamic events, including reduced preload and hypotension. Diuretics are typically avoided due to concern for reduced preload. In patients with rheumatic heart disease, antibiotic prophylaxis is recommended, typically with penicillin. Prophylaxis should be continued for at least 10 years after the last episode of rheumatic fever and until the age of 40. Lifelong prophylaxis is indicated for patients who are at high risk, including teachers and daycare workers. Surgical replacement of the aortic valve is indicated when symptoms develop and is the only effective therapy for severe AS. It should be done soon after the onset of symptoms due to the high risk of sudden death and 50% mortality at 2 to 3 years after symptom onset. It is important to consider whether the patient would benefit more from a mechanical or a prosthetic valve, with the principal consideration being the increased durability of the mechanical valve though with the increased burden of lifelong anticoagulation. Replacement of the aortic valve should be performed in asymptomatic patients with severe AS if they are undergoing CABG, an operation on the aorta, or another valve operation. Aortic valve replacement improves symptoms and survival in symptomatic patients. In patients who are not operative candidates due to comorbidity, options include aortic balloon valvotomy, cautious afterload reduction, and cautious diuretic use. These therapies do not prolong life and are indicated only to improve symptoms. Transcatheter aortic valve implantation involves placement of a replacement aortic valve either via a retrograde approach up the aorta or a transapical approach through the left ventricle. These techniques are showing promise and will likely eventually be a comparable option to surgery in some patient groups, or a viable option if the patient is not a surgical candidate due to comorbidity. In summary, it is important to recognize that the physical exam findings can be used to identify patients with aortic stenosis, and that disease severity can be assessed by echocardiogram. Finally, patients with AS who are surgical candidates should be referred for aortic valve replacement shortly after symptom onset. I would like to acknowledge my wife, Dr. Anna Dolner, for her help reviewing this presentation.